Okay, so we saw the basic idea of modulation and how it works for a continuous signal, for an analog signal. But nowadays, we have most of the signals and most of the transmissions done are actually in a digital format. We saw in the previous videos how to actually digitalize a signal. So how we take an analog signal and we sample it and we slice it into bits, let's say, and we record data on each of the levels. And we saw that we can digitalize a signal. And if we have a high enough sampling rate, we can always restore it back to the analog. But how do we actually form a signal which is going to be used to transmit sequence of zeros and ones? So far we saw how to transmit a wave packet which has a certain shape. So the carrier wave was modified, one of its characteristics was modified depending on the characteristics of the baseband signal. But what if our baseband signal is not a continuous signal, but a sequence of bits? How do we form a signal in this way? Well, in this case, the modulations are essentially digital modulations, I say. And what we get is actually a change. Again, we have amplitude, frequency, and phase, the three characteristics of a sine wave. But in this case, we are more or less jump changing them. So discontinually changing them based on a logical function, which gives zero or one, so the bits. Now, the first type of modulation, so the first method of forming digitally modulated, if you like, signal, is the so-called ASK, so amplitude shift keying. Now, what we do in this case is the amplitude of a signal is actually a logical function, which depending on the value of a bit changes. So if we have a bit one, then the value will be one. If we have a bit zero, then the value will be, let's say, 0.5, so half of one. And what we get if we have a sequence of bits is that we have the amplitude jump changing every time that a new bit is measured. So we have a logical circuit which essentially, depending on what it reads as bits, it changes and actively modifies the amplitude of a signal, and you can see the result. So for example, if we have a sequence 0 0 1 0 1 1 0, you can see that the amplitude whenever we have zeros is lower, twice as low as when we have ones. Now, of course, it doesn't have to be exactly twice as low. You can use different values here. You could have entirely the amplitude disappearing when we have zeros. Of course, this is not a very good idea, because if you have a long sequence of zeros, you can lose the signal. But essentially, this is the idea of shift keying, if you like, depending on the logical bit which comes, the sine wave in such a way as to form a digitally modulated signal. Now, the same idea goes for frequency modulation, of course. So we have, again, just the same sequence of bits, just as an example. But in this case, the logical function is inserted inside of the frequency. So we have the central frequency of the carrier plus delta omega. This delta omega is, again, a small deviation of frequency times the logical function. So in this case, the logical function takes, for example, plus minus one. So whenever we have a logical one, whenever we have a bit one, we get a bit higher frequency. So we get our frequency is modified by this delta omega. So it's the carrier frequency plus delta omega. And whenever we have zero as a bit, this logical function gives us minus one. And as a result, our frequency is a bit lower. So we have omega minus delta omega. So the carrier frequency minus the small deviation. And the result you can see immediately is that whenever we have zeros, the frequency, of course, is lower. Whenever we have ones, it's higher. And again, stating what we spoke about previously, this method is more secure in terms of noises, because amplitude is easily modified by interference. But if you encode the information within the frequency, it's much higher to it. It's pretty much impossible to change it by external interference. So there is one more characteristics, just like with our analog modulations, and this is the phase. So we can do the same thing. We can include a logical function which changes the phase of the signal depending on the value of the bit. So a very simple realization of this case is the so-called BPSK, so binary phase shift keying. Why is it binary? Because we are changing the phase by only two values. So we have plus pi, so plus 180 degrees, and minus pi, so minus 180 degrees. And what we have, you can see, for example, is that any time that we go from 0 to 1, we have the value 1 of the logical function, and anytime we switch from 1 to 0, we have the value of 0. So in this case, each bit does not correspond actually to a specific value of the phase, but only to changes in the phase. So if we start from 0, then we are going to have a simple sine wave until we have a change from 0 to 1, at which point we're going to have a jump in the phase. And by detecting these jumps in the phase and by knowing the original bit, we can immediately restore the full sequence, of course. Now, things are a bit different in terms of the bandwidth with the digital signals. So in order to properly restore a signal using this type of modulation, so this digital type of modulation, we need the central frequency of the baseband plus two of its highest, let's say, most important frequency components. So we can show that this is equivalent to twice the Nyquist bandwidth, or it's equal to the frequency of sampling, essentially. So if we have this type of modulation, ASK, BPSK, or FSK, we always have this bandwidth. So for all three signals, we get the same bandwidth, which is equal to the frequency of sampling, which is equal to twice the Nyquist bandwidth. Now, in all of these cases, the transmission speed is simply 1 over the period of sampling, because we get 1 bit per each period of sampling. So it is essentially always the same. It's again the frequency of sampling. So the ratio of the bit rate to the bandwidth actually gives us what is known as spectral efficiency. So it gives us how many bits per second we get per unit bandwidth. And for all of these methods, for BPSK, ASK, and FSK, it's always the same, it's just 1. So we cannot exceed this efficiency of 1 bit per second per hertz. So you can see that if we want to see how we're going to emit and what's going to be our emission rate, we can use this formula. We can see that we're going to have 1 bit per second for every hertz of bandwidth. So if we want to transmit, let's say, 100 bits per second, we're going to need 100 hertz in terms of bandwidth, and so on. So how can we increase efficiency? Now, with all of these methods, we get the efficiency is independent of really of which one of the parameters we modify. It's always the same. Well, the answer actually is that we can modify more things at the same time. So far, we considered only modulations, which change one of the three characteristics of a sine wave, but we do it one by one. So we change either only the amplitude, only the frequency, or only the phase. But we can do all three, or we can do two of them at the same time. Or we can change again just one of them by simply including more states. So far we've had two states. So for ASK, FSK, and BPSK, we had just two states of the amplitude, two states of the frequency, two states of the phase. But what if we include more states? So a very simple example, which is actually used a lot, is the quadrature phase shift keying, so QPSK. And in this type of modulation, we have, it's again the same idea as BPSK, but instead of binary, instead of two states for the phase, we have four states, we have quadrature. So you see, if the change of phase is in the first quadrant, we have the sequence of two bits being 0, 0. If we have the change of phase being in the second quadrant, we have 1, 0, and so on. In the third quadrant, we have 1, 1, in the fourth quadrant, we have 1, 0. So each measurement, each sampling, if you like, actually gives us information about two bits, because by measuring the phase change at a given point, we actually get two bits simultaneously. So in this case, the transmission rate actually increases by 2, and the bandwidth required remains the same, so our efficiency jumps by 2. So we're going to have 2 bits per second per unit bandwidth instead of 1. And essentially, this is exactly the idea. We have more states, so we haven't really changed the way we modulate, we have only changed the amount of possibilities, so the logical function is a bit more complicated. Of course, the beamforming network could be a bit more complicated, but we actually encode two states, two bits, in just one characteristic. We can include many more phases, we can do 8 or 16 or so on. The problem is that the more phase states we include, the harder it is to actually differentiate, the less secure we are in terms of errors. Because if we have phases very nearby, very close by, what we get is that we can easily mistake one for the other, and we can make a mistake with a lot of bits. So a very, let's say, a much more robust way to do it is to actually modify two parameters at the same time. And this is the case with 16QAM. So this is, a phase, but also an amplitude modulation. And we have 16 states. So you see that in this case, these 16 states, they actually allow us to get information about 4 bits simultaneously. So you remember that if we have 2 bits, we have 4 states. If we have 4 bits, we have 16 states and so on. So in this case, what we have is, so you see that we actually have, again, on this plot, you can see the phase. Essentially, we are getting, depending on where we are. So if our angle is, let's say, roughly 22 degrees, we're going to have 1001. If our angle, however, is, let's say, 45 degrees, if it's pi divided by 4, what we have are two possible configurations. So we could have 1101 or 1000. So depending on our amplitude, the amplitude is also required, not only the phase, but the amplitude, we choose which one of them. So again, if our angle is a bit higher, so if it's roughly 67 degrees, we see we only have one state, and this is 1100, and so on. So whenever we have ambiguity only due to the phase, the amplitude is used to actually distinguish which sequence of 4 bits is the real one. But in some cases, again, we only need the amplitude. So this method is rather robust. It has, let's say, the downside of relying a little on the amplitude, but by modifying two of the states, it's much more robust in a sense, and it allows us a much higher efficiency. So 4 times higher than the ASK, BPSK and the FSK. So these are the main methods used to form digital signals. And essentially we saw that we can extend this further on, so we can have much more, let's say, complicated modulation schemes. We can include frequency as well, so we can maybe modify all of them. We can have several schemes simultaneously in order to ensure higher security.